Zothis is on the streaming. He's on YouTube, so I see him rocking out to it. Welcome to Enlightened Masculinity. I'm your host, Yogi Chris, PhD, founder of Ninth Limb Yoga, Captain. IMC Nation Captain had this nice shirt made up. And coming to you live from Base One Stoic Temple in San Jose, California. So this is a red pill show, about masculinity, enlightenment. And what is that in the modern sense? You know, there's depths to understanding the universe from deep universal principles. And if you speak with higher and higher level spiritualists, Instagram always cuts off right when I start. They ended it. Lame. I'll just start it again for them real quick. So you'll get higher and higher level, like ethereal principles and things. And, you know, supposedly those are going to be true on all levels. It's like a fractal universe. So deep universal principles like cause and effect, all things are cause and effect. You could see that from the most mundane to the most high altitude thoughts of, you know, capitalism or government or aliens or anything. Cause and effect universe. Telegram in bio. Instagram cut me off. Okay. Looks frozen right now though. So anyway, today's episode came to me when I was coming back from the park, and I crossed paths with this guy that was walking his dog, and old man, maybe 70 or so. And I saw him walking around. It was like a big, big park. I saw him walking around while I was doing my thing. I had my journal. I was doing my thing. And when I left, I was kind of looking down as I was walking. I was listening to an audio book. And his dog, it kind of bothered me a little bit, was ahead of him and kind of went up to me. It was like a friendly yellow lab or something, but I just don't like dogs that I don't know, like kind of coming up to me, to my hand, whatever. I don't know. It's just like, I feel like it's out of order. Like the man should have the dog under the control. So I have this like criticism going on in me as I'm walking past the guy. We're going in opposite directions. And the hand that the dog had walked past, I kind of pulled it up a little bit. And then as I was passing him, he said hi. And I opened my palm and, you know, as a wave. And he said, how you doing? And I said, good. And we just kept walking past each other. And right after that, like about a second after that, I realized, like, you know, in a good communication with somebody that you know, like any of you, if you were like, how you doing? I would answer and reply back, how are you doing? Something like that. You know, it would be a complete communication. But with a stranger or whatever, you know, I almost felt like how a hot girl might do to you, you know, a guy. Like it happens so many times in Messenger or whatever, you message a girl, how's it going? And she's like, good. And doesn't reply any interest. And we would call that like disinterest or just like no interest. And I felt bad that I did that to the guy. I didn't mean to. I was listening to my audiobook and I just didn't respond fast enough. We'd already walked past each other. But then I was hit with a real deep, heavy feeling down at the bottom of my heart, right at the bottom of my rib cage. And it was a sinking feeling. And it was the feeling that everybody does that to this guy, or everybody does this to that guy, let's say. Everybody does this to that guy. That guy, I mean, he wasn't like particularly awkward or peculiar older man. He was just old guy walking his dog. Who knows? Maybe he's married, maybe not. Who knows? But I got the feeling, which I could be wrong, but it came to me out of nowhere. It wasn't like I was thinking on those lines at all. And I don't normally think like this about people. I've had this similar thought before, but like, it's not like a regular thing. I think everybody's pretty lonely. When I get down to, you know, the brass tacks, bare bones, like breaking it down, even in IMC Nation, but outside of IMC Nation, man, it's just, you know, even if they have friends, it's so shallow and superficial. It doesn't have depth. And if it does have depth, it's like, it's depth in one angle. Like they did drugs together or they played sports together or something. But outside, like as a whole life thing, there's not a lot of agreement between people and their friendships are flimsy. And so that guy, it just crossed. It was like, you know how like sometimes I'll get this visual when I have like a thought of inspiration where it almost to me, it seems like almost like on my inner eye, my third eye or something. It seems like a horizontal lightning bolt goes through my brain. When I get like a thought of inspiration, sometimes I've seen this visual. It's not like every time, but it's nice. It's like a little, and it's like, you know, that's an inspired thought or that's, who knows what that is. Maybe it's actually just a neuron firing and I literally feel it, but I'll get this visual of what I experience when I get like a thought that is, it's not a necessarily profound thought. It's like, it's a thought that I almost want to consider more pure. It's like a pure thought. Like I had no other thoughts that led to it. I wasn't trying to think of that thought. I was doing this and then boom, I feel like, oh, and then I have this thought. If that makes sense, if anybody's had that kind of experience where it's like a jolt across the mind or the brain. Well, this was a jolt across the bottom of my heart. And this jolt was, man, that guy is lonely. That guy is sad. That guy is walking his dog. And it's not like, man, if I had a dog, I'd love to walk my dog. So I hopefully people wouldn't pick up from me that like loneliness, I don't consider myself lonely. And I'm very involved in communication so much every day. Like, I mean, I guess I could be, but I'm not lonely. But that guy, I felt like, man, I didn't reciprocate his greeting very well. And that guy, oh, that's like the future of so many men, because who is making friends with guys past their 20s? But then you have 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s. Jesus. By the time you're in your 50s, people you know are going to be dying. 60s, it's going to be like a thing that you're still alive. 70s, it's going to be like countdown, who's left? 80s is just going to be like, man, I don't even know what's left. You might be fortunate, but how long does it go on for? So I kind of got this kind of almost like a movie or a foreshadowing through my mind, through my consciousness about men in general, And I saw how I am different. I'm in IMC Nation. Man, people don't get it. Girls don't get it. Girls are in the same boat. They just don't get it. Like, these girls, the best they can hope for is like the biannual fly somewhere to hang out with some old girlfriends that have moved on and moved away and they're somewhere else. And so they have that twice a year vacation somewhere, drinking and whatever. Not, they don't even get along with those women. It's just like they get along with them better than other people because they don't know how to get along. They're so shackled and frozen. And this is the future for women and men, for most of them. And I saw how my life is different, how at 36, I feel younger and more alive than in my early 20s. I was dead to the world in a lot of ways because I didn't communicate. So I didn't exist. After wrestling, how much did I exist? I existed to my professors. I existed to whoever's groups I was involved in group projects with. And I existed to the guys that I smoked weed with and played frisbee golf with, who were pretty much ex-wrestlers. And then I made myself more important by dealing weed. So now I existed to 60 people or whatever that would come and get weed from me on a regular basis. Wow, did I feel important? I existed. But moving forward, what's that going to become? Like, follow the drug dealer path forward, what's that going to become? Follow the not drug dealer path where I'm not communicating with anybody. So then I move on to PhD, I stop selling weed, and now I'm just communicating with the people in academia or whatever. And that's quite a group. That's quite a docile, numb, intellectual group. You know, that's, man, that's a very sheltered, guarded, a docile, like I'm saying, like segment of society. You know, it's so different. The different segments in university, the sorority and fraternity, the Greek life, the athletes, the nerds, the multicultural people like the salsa dancers and the visual arts students and whatever. And then the, you know, and you could even say like the musicians, whatever. And then there's like the nobodies that don't do anything. They're not even involved in anything. They're isolated. Like, are you going to make more friends as you grow older? So you're going to network and connect with people around your neighborhood, let's say, or the people that you do business with. You've got to go to Home Depot regularly for, you know, shop what you do. You build shit and you start getting to know the manager there, the workers there, the lumber supply person. You get connect, like that becomes the people, you know, you frequent that local pub. Or, I mean, shit, what if you work at home and you're doing like marketing, whatever, like who do you interact with? How are you going to meet and have friends and relate? You're going to end up like that 70-year-old guy. Oh, man, such an empty feeling. How many years he'd gone on for just not having real social interactions? What's that become? So I felt for him, and I saw how I've put myself in a position since, let's say, 27, I started waking up to my mind, and at 29 or so, I got involved with, or 28 or so, I got involved with IMC. And at 29, I got heavily involved with IMC. And then so for 7 years now, it's just been heavy involvement, as heavy as could be since then. And so that's 7 years of having frequent communication that's just built. I mean, originally it wasn't that frequent. I talked with Malachi or whatever, but I was part of something. I was part of a team. And I wasn't very vocal in the beginning. It was on Tiny Chat. We didn't use Zoom. We had Tiny Chat at the time, or Ustream. And so we were using Ustream for Saturday Night Live lectures. And we would use Tiny Chat for like all the collaborations with Vince Kelvin and Arash. That was mostly what it was. And then, you know, the communication with other IMC men was, you know, a minority, if any, of my communication compared to academia, PhD, compared to yoga business and yoga people, friends, girls I was trying to get with. And over time, a lot of things whittled out. And then I just had like yoga business communication lines and IMC communication lines. I took more and more responsibilities to the IMC lines. And I really saw these guys that I was interacting with as very similar to me. I also saw the yoga people as very similar to me in that sense. You could imagine if there was another IMC guy that was like hella into yoga, we might hella get along. Maybe. I mean, we'd probably nerd out on an anatomy or whatever. Who knows how it would go. And you see that with the meditators or the sorcerers or whatever. We get along in a different way, a different level. And the guys that are also purely about game, we get along in a different way because I'm a scholar of the evolutionary psychology and that stuff. It's not that I've read everything, but I read thorough. I read thoroughly. So who is that guy? And how do we not become that? That old man that's so lonely that I feel for his heart. You know, in getting involved in the movement and so feeling part of a team and studying that information, showing up to events. The first time that you meet a guy for the second time at an event. Or the third time at an event. And it's like you start to get to know that person. You connect on social media with the guy. You see his posts. So he's over there getting blasted on his social media because people don't agree with him. And you're over here getting blasted on your social media. And he's seeing you go through the rings of fire and you're seeing him go through the rings of fire. And you're growing together. You're bonding like two guys that were cutting weight for wrestling. Like you're through your hardship, which is individually experienced. You bond because they're going through it too. So you see people who like burn their bridges or handle haters. Especially it's about the same philosophy. So you're like in that fight with him. And this philosophy is just a very simple, basic philosophy about ownership of your life, taking responsibility for your life. And a lot of that is going to be a self-image thing. Where do you see yourself in the future? What do you see as your potential? Definitely, you're not very good at putting words on it. Some better than others. If you journal about it or talk about it more, you'll get better at it. But you have fleeting images and movie reels in your mind about what you see for yourself, what you want, what you know is possible for you. You believe on some level it's possible for you. And you see yourself in that, and you feel yourself in that self-image, in that vision of the future. Or rather, you have a self-image in that vision. And it doesn't mean that your vision is accurate 100%. You could envision yourself flying like an eagle. We have a language and philosophy here that's a universe of your consciousness or somewhere. It's a dimension of your consciousness that you're tapping into. But in this dimension, on this planet, it's probably not possible that you just grow wings and fly. So you could have an image of that, but that may not be realistic. There's lots of images that you may have of yourself, like jumping 10 feet. Maybe you're just going to have a 10-foot vertical. That might not really be possible. That might help you, though, stretch the limits of what you're capable of. But how accurate and realistic is your vision, like in the physical sense, like the physics of it? I want to think out of the box. Almost outlandishly, outstandingly, and vividly and all of that. But it also needs to adhere to the laws of nature. As I know them, I may be false on them. And so that's, you know, where, you know, we can get super creative with it. But I'm just kind of making the point that you have a self-image of yourself in the future and your goals. And there's a lot of angles to view your role in your view, in your vision. You have a place in your vision, and how do you look from the left side of you? How do you look from the right side of you? From above, from in front, from behind? How do you look in so many sense of like what are you wearing? How are you smelling? What are you, what's on your face? What color, what colors are we working with? What's the posture like? And then we have so many other kind of fourth dimensional angles, not the cardinal directions, left, right, up, down, forward, back, but let's say in this situation or that situation, how do you look? How are you responding? How do you see yourself in your ideal? Now, you can focus on it as a vision, but I'm saying that it's already happening as flying by images that you get throughout your day or in your meditation or in moments of inspiration or before bed or who knows, that you have visions of what you see for yourself possible. A lot of times when you're doing like a redundant thing, like walking or driving or taking a jog or a bicycle or something, like that's when you'll have visions of, you know, what you see for yourself. And maybe other times too. So I want you to know that there is you, but you are in context to your environment and the world around you. And how you're going to bring about the condition that you want to experience is going to be through interaction with other people. You're not going to make it alone, like that old guy with his dog. He had some vision of himself in the future, no doubt. Everybody does. They have goals they're going for. That's why they save money, or their vision is a white picket fence around a house or something, or that vacation or whatever. They have a vision of themselves in the future. And maybe what they haven't assessed, but they definitely haven't assessed because they're ignorant of, is it attractive or not? Is your vision of yourself really in the laws of physics and the laws of nature, is how you see yourself really attractive to women? Is it attractive to the money you want? Is it attractive to society, to your group, to your family, to yourself? It's probably attractive to yourself. But is the lifestyle you see for yourself attractive to the kind of people that you want to be with, want to be interacting with? You have so many preferences that are subjective and unique to you. And just because they're unique doesn't make them good or extra special. Your uniqueness is great that you're unique. But a lot of your uniqueness is not by your choosing. You're just unique because you had unique experiences growing up and those left impressions. And so you have these impressions that you're not conscious of why. You don't necessarily need to be conscious of why your preference is this or that, but just know that a lot of your preferences are kind of hand-me-down, passed down, just reflections of your parents or your caregivers in a positive or negative direction. So like they may have that preference, they pass it on to you, or they may have it. And so you definitely don't have that preference and you go the other way, but it's somehow influenced by their preferences and you were formed. And it's not that you got to change that, but there may be more pleasant and pleasurable options. And by calibrating your preferences to the social dynamic of the people that you are in your life or that you want in your life, you get out of your patterned identity and into the identity of your creation, the identity of your vision, by letting go of the aspects of you and parts of your character that are counterproductively influencing your environment, counter creatively influencing the people around you, counter creative relative to the creation you want. It's creative in some sense, destructive in another sense, like the gazelle has a different agenda than the lion kind of story. You know, what's good for the lion is bad for the gazelle. What's good for the gazelle is bad for the lion. So in life, what's creative, let's say in an economy, what makes you money, the other guy doesn't make money. Which other guy? Some other guy. The money that flows to you doesn't flow to someone else. You can't just like have a dollar and then do a magic trick and all of a sudden have $2. So like women, you know, if that woman's going to be yours, that means she's not someone else's. They say, what is it? The Pareto principle, 20% of the guys get 80% of the women. There's a lot more men. This is an interesting sentence that comes from evolutionary psychology. there's many more men. Ponder this. There's many more men on earth that will go mateless, without a mate. Many more men than women on earth will go mateless their whole life. And what is it? The average number of sexual partners that a man has, it's very small, actually. It's in the single digits on the average. When you get 80% of the women. So in this, we'll go just like 10 more minutes. If you guys got any comments or hand raises, we have the time warping fourth dimensional lecture series known as Mindbender. Mindbender started this morning with a very powerful lecture. I don't remember the last time I took so many notes in a lecture. I just couldn't stop. And because it was like sentences that I didn't want to miss out, they just kind of disappear into the universe. Even though it's recorded, I could go back and watch. But I watch two lectures a day every day. Like, and I do business all day throughout. So I don't have time to like just rewatch lectures unless I'm going to miss out on Cosmic Disclosure, which is the tough decision. Still a lot to catch up with on that. You know, I'm learning so much about the world and the universe around me watching that. And it doesn't mean that it's true, but it makes sense, a lot of it. And so it expands my thinking. And it's amazing. I want to tell you a story. I don't know that you'll get it. Has anyone here done psychedelics?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So this story happened to me 2 or 3 days ago. Mm-hmm. I didn't do any psychedelics, but I had a psychedelic experience. It was very quick. You know how, like, if you have water in your eye, or maybe you just opened your eyes after sleep or some experience like this, and your eye focuses. It's like something in front of you. Like if I was looking at that picture, or you look at someone's face or something, it's kind of blurry. And then your eye focuses, and the image, whatever's in front of you, comes into focus. So we've maybe experienced this more often at like the optometrist, or, you know, with the eye machine, or, you know, maybe some contraption or machine or something like that. Maybe a telescope or a binoculars or something where we know what the experience of focusing on an image is. I'm saying, have you ever had that experience with your own eyeball? Or at least maybe you could conceptualize it, conceive of having your eye, like you witness from inside your skull, you witness your eyeball focus on what you're seeing, where it goes from blurry to you focus on it without squinting or whatever. It's just the eye focuses. Okay, so you could probably imagine that happening. So now what I did is I looked up. I was journaling in nature, and I looked up and I saw this buzzing flying thing. It was an insect. And I heard my mind say, it's a butterfly. And then I don't know that my eyes focused. I think my inner eye focused, because what was a butterfly refocused and transformed into a dragonfly. Now, you might say that I just mistook the dragonfly for a butterfly. No, I saw a butterfly, and then my mind focused, and it was no. I had projected a butterfly onto what it was. And then as I looked at it, it became more real to me that it was the dragonfly. It changed because the whole thing is experienced in my mind. The dragonfly, the butterfly, I'm not touching it. Even if I was, that's in my mind too. So I'm looking at my mind, looking at the dragonfly. I'm looking at my mind, look out my eyeballs at the dragonfly. And somewhere in there, it got lost in translation so that for a brief half a second, it was a butterfly. And it focused, I saw my mind, not my eyes, I saw my mind focus it into a dragonfly. And I thought to myself, I only know what that is because on this earth, I've seen that many times. And I've been told that's what it is. And I've identified it as that many times. And so I have this like automatic where I know, like if someone if someone said, give me an A note, and they were like, and they were like, give me a B note, and they're like, and it's like, you know, you have a guitar and they're like, play me a C chord, ding, and you do like, you don't even have to think about it. You know that hand position, there it is. You don't have to think about it. That's a dragonfly. You see it, boom. Mind knows how to play that note. And so many things are, I mean, the power of my mind. I made that dragonfly a butterfly unconsciously, effortlessly. I saw it as a butterfly. I remembered in the movie Scanner Darkly with Keanu Reeves, and they were talking about this substance D, D for death. It was a drug that they would take to get high, and you know, it would just like destroy your brain. And at some point they knew that the person had done too much, because when they took those Rorschach tests, the ink blots for the psychology, and other things like blindfold yourself and like hold some object and tell the person what the object is, like feel it out with your hand. Like there's some disconnect and you're not able to identify the right shape. You see a dog in the ink blot and it's like a pyramid or something. It's like not even close. And so that's when they send them off to like, I mean, there's a whole plot to that, a plot to that movie that, you know, is not important here, but there's, the point is that there's an experience of recognition of what the object is that's separate from the object, and it's separate from you. And we've learned to recognize objects by our conditioning, by our education, indoctrination, by even what's just been beaten into us. And so we see life and social situations and all sorts of situations. We're projecting a meaning onto it that might not be the real thing. That's just what we are telling ourselves it is. That's like the dragonfly is the butterfly. Did you see that butterfly? Where? I saw a dragonfly. No, a butterfly. And then they're arguing about it. And it's like, you just saw it wrong. But was it your eyeball that saw it? No, it was your mind that saw it wrong. The eyeball is just an instrument. It's like saying the telescope saw it wrong. But then people get into, let's say a man and a woman gets into an argument about some situation or experience. How much you want to bet one of them is totally misperceiving it? Probably both of them. How much are any of us really perceiving? That's what I'm talking about. Cosmic disclosure was right before that. That's what got me into this. Because more and more, each episode, practically, I'm seeing more of the story that has been fed to us and told to us. Plausibly is not real. It's plausibly false. Like discovery of the New World, slave trade, like all the major religions, lots of major architecture. I mean, meaning what? Like the pyramids and all the ancient structures and megalithic structures and, you know, so many things. The elites, which in the past, the days of old, was like the royalty. The blue bloods, just the history of the planet and what's going on now with this like kind of split population of this minority of elites, financial and resource wise, running the planet. And there's a whole story that we're given that has been patterned into us so that we recognize certain things as something that they're not. The story keeps us in check. We are farming animals that are caged not by bars but by the boundaries in our consciousness. And it's ideas like this, speech like this, philosophy, podcasts like this that I think will keep me valuable and interacting with my brothers into my 70s, into my 80s. I'm only going to keep getting better at this. I'm 7 years at this, 36. At 46, I'll be 17 years into this. I think my delivery will be better. The words will be crisper. The ideas will be more evolved. I think to myself, man, the way that the movement is now, we got Shamir here. We got Palacio here. I live with Sultan and Fernando. When I was 29 and I first came around, how would I have gotten along with these guys? If they were at the level they're at now, how would I have put myself into IMC Nation when I first got started. Given IMC wasn't like this when I came around. So if I were to enter now as a newbie at 29 the way I was, man, I don't know how far I would get, how much I would participate at first, and who I would bond with, what my future would hold, given that they didn't, it wasn't like that. We have things laid out for guys. They're coming in, and we got bases, we got jobs, we got camps. There wasn't those things. So this and that. I recommend getting involved, of course. Everybody here is involved except a couple guys. One guy. That's the live attendees. The recordings are doing really well on enlightened masculinity. So like everything, that just keeps growing. One day we'll be at 10 million and people will be like, how'd you blow up? And I'll be like, dude, you didn't see I posted 2,000 episodes. We were going at it for like 10 years. For 10 years, I paid $20 a month to post my podcast. So that's like $240 a year. That's $2,400 I invested in myself just for that. You know, plus the Zoom was like, I'm not caring about that. I'm just saying, like, one day you're a success and people will ask how did it happen and they won't know. They won't know how much you put into it. So you got to enjoy what you do. And I, at the, you know, day in and day out, I replace activities and the mundane, repetitive activities with more and more things that I enjoy and how I want to be. I put tasks off to staff members and apprentices and whatever, and I talk with them. You could call it like teach them what I need them to do, but I talk with them. I have those relationships with them. And that's great. And the movement continues and the information is passed on and new guys get the value and they make their life more valuable. So this is part of the path, streaming, podcasting, whatever you call it, recording yourself, getting that biofeedback, connecting with other guys and practicing this philosophy, living a life of discipline. Like I was thinking the other day, or maybe it was this morning or something, like the practices that I do that AZD has taught, the private moment, the community with nature, the creation, the everything, throwaway monologue, is so similar to the wake up. It's so similar to the wake up, because if you can't make your wake up every day, you're definitely not going to do those other practices every day. And when you do those other practices every day, I'm telling you, like, you are going to pull yourself away from the illusion in your mind that you're so attached to. It's so solid in your mind of the way that the world is. And it's probably false. I'm telling you, when you watch Cosmic Disclosure, it's going to be like, man, that's going on this planet. I live on this planet and they never told me all of those years, this would have been the most interesting thing to learn in school. And they like deliberately hid it and made me learn all this other bullshit. That's like not even prerequisite to that stuff. It's just totally on a different line. It's just a distraction. It'd be one thing if like you have to learn algebra before trigonometry, before calculus. Like, okay, so I had to learn all that bullshit that I'm never going to use. Okay, you do sometimes use it later, but it's like I could have just learned the stuff I needed to know. Like, I didn't need to know all of it. But this is just like some tangent. Like, here, come over here and learn basketball, and I'm trying to be a stock trader or something. It's not even that. It's like, it's worse than that. It's like, go do a mission trip in a third world country so that you can, I don't even know. Man, I can make everything relate, but it's like totally, it's as unrelated as possible. It's like, learn Satanism so that you could be a better Catholic. Okay, so Always, you had your hand quickly raised, and then I got to go because I got to change. If you're there, you could unmute, or if there's nothing, then we could end it. Any questions or comments? I know I talk a lot, and then you guys, it might take a second to, like, you know, locate if there's something you want to say.
Cosmic Disclosure, is that AZD Tech? Because that's the first time I'm hearing of it.
Sorry, come again?
When you talk about cosmic disclosure, is that AZD Tech or is that
something? No, it's a TV show. Yeah, it's a TV show on Gaia TV. So if you go to Gaia TV, it's like $12 a month. So very entertaining, very mind blowing, and yeah, it'll do all those things that I said about. Okay, brothers, I don't want to be late for the gigs that we got going on here. Just going to spend an hour out with the Guardian trainees. They're here. Shamir from Base 4 Vegas and Palacio from Base 2 San Jose. They're here doing Guardian training. It's a residency. They live here. They got their stuff here and everybody's changing and getting ready to just do an hour out with AZD, you know, dinner conversation. Like, it's very nice, very calibrating, very smoothing. It's real amazing how tapped in he is 24/7 with that. It's just a way of being and talking, a rhythm. And then when you add in music and you add in control of movement, like being in the vehicle and where we go to eat. And then, of course, those small little interactions with anybody along the way. It's just going to, each thing pulls you out of your head and your reality, because it's a movement that is free from the habits, free from your habits anyway. It is habited. He's made a habit of himself for sure. That makes sense. I mean, humans live on habits. Of course, he moves in habitual ways. The more, I mean, as you come around, you see, oh, he is human. He does things. He has ways of, like everybody has repeating way, like how you walk or certain gestures you make. But then you'll also come to appreciate the creativity. It is on that constant creative, constantly out-creating the past and not getting stuck in the patterns of your personality and identity and your game, your strategy, you know? Don't be that 70-year-old guy. He's living in his social awareness of back in his 20s, which is like 1950 or something, you know. All right. I'll see you guys soon. Hope to see you on Mindbender, imcbase1.com. It's on Early Bird for...